So welcome everybody back to our 6:31 regular Board of Education meeting for Thursday, January 12, 2016. Please call, calling to our call roll, please.
Ms. Arnold?
Here.
Ms. Hunt?
Here.
Mr. Morrison?
Here.
Mr. Gano?
Here.
Mr. Taylor?
Here.
We have a call.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is presentations. Turn it over to Mr. Hunt.
Thank you, Mr. Gano. Mrs. Gano, members of the board, each month we spotlight a school. So tonight we're excited to have Ankeny Middle School here. So at this point, I'd like to invite Mr. Dale Wren, our voting principal, up, and he will be able to start the show for us here.
Good evening, board members, community members, families, and students. Thank you for taking time out of your evening to be here tonight. My name is Dale Wren. I'm the principal at Ankeny Middle School. And tonight I want to talk a little bit about Ankeny Middle School. We'll go back on. I'm used to this device here. I'm going to talk a little bit about the overall umbrella of student support that we have, ways that we support them academically, socially, emotionally. And then I will turn it over to our web leaders at the end, and they will explain a little bit about what web is. Overall, we have a couple different methods to build culture and build. This year is our first year of our PBIS program, which is a positive behavior support program. We have had historically at the time an OBAS anti-bullying program, and those that have 5 monthly sessions that run kind of congruent with the character education program. And then, as I mentioned, we also have our web program, which stands for Where Everyone Belongs. Talk a little bit about each program. We have OBAS meetings each month. We have sort of a targeted topic that we are going to address each month with follow-up activities for each group to kind of address various aspects of that issue. And then we also have a very strong character education program that meets on Wednesdays as well. And we work with Peter Creek High School. We have monthly visits from some of their student programs. And typically within any school year, we try to pick 2 service projects throughout the year to get students and the entire student body involved in. Last fall, we had a penny drive to support the Honor Flight program, which sent veterans to Washington, D.C. Memorial. I think we had set a goal just to send 2. We ended up having enough money to send 7, which is really great if you know anything about the program. So our students really turn out for events like that. This year was our first year of the PBIS program. And we meet weekly in a charter period. And last year we had a group of about 10 or 12 teachers that we formed a committee. And really what we wanted to accomplish with PBIS is build a culture. What do we want to ingrain in our students? So we came up with a very, very slogan. You can see it there. It just has 3 aspects. Be kind, work hard, problem solve. It's easy to remember. And as I work with students through a variety of different things, regardless of behavior, positive or negative, I always say, well, were you being kind? Nope, yeah, or no. Were you working hard? Were you problem solving? So it's kind of a great way to frame behavior. I use it on my own student or my kids at home. You know, I wonder if I could have a brother, were you being kind? I don't know, but not as effective at home. And then we have our web leaders who are here tonight, and I'm going to turn it over to them at this point. But they do a lot in our building. They assist with our 6th grade orientation, which is quite an undertaking. They are there throughout the year to support the 6th graders as they transition to middle school, which that is a big transition, and a lot goes into that. Right away in August, they develop a familiar base for their students as they work through this thing. So at this time, I will call on Katie McDonald, Abby Roeder, Matthew Roeder, Jenna Hamilton, and Isha Bombry, good to be here tonight.
Grader at Ankeny Middle School, and I'm also a web leader. I joined
am glad that because I remember my sixth grade orientation and how they introduced me to new people and how during the school year they taught us about bowling, and I thought it was really cool, and I knew I wanted to be involved and part of it when I was old enough. The part I like most about being a web leader is being able to interact with sixth graders and to help prepare them for just some of the many challenges they will face throughout their middle school experience and the rest of their lives. I feel like the web program really does help the sixth graders get out of their bubbles and stop bullying, and also help bystanders help out victims of bullying. I really do feel like web is where everybody belongs.
Hi, my name is Abigail Murray, and I'm a 7th grader at APS. And as a web leader, we are supposed to help the sixth graders and help them feel comfortable in school. And we also help them with bullying issues, things like that. And my favorite thing about being a web leader is that we get to interact with the sixth graders.
Hi, my name is Matthew River, and I get to make a middle school 7th grader, and I'm also a web leader. I chose to be a web leader because I remember when I was in 6th grade, my web leader helped me get used to the different people around me and got me used to the school. And I really like being a web leader because I get to help different kids and meet new faces all the time.
Hello, my name is Patricia Mountain. I'm a third grade at the middle school, and I'm also a web leader. I became a web leader because in my 6th grade year, I have a member from Trade Buying, which none of the kids were meeting over there, and it's just quite I didn't know anybody. The only people I had been was in like 2nd grade, and I went to Fairbrook. I don't know for that. So my web leader in 6th grade helped me like meet new people, and I was friends with a few people that were in my web group. And I would be able to talk like about experience about long time. One of my favorite things from web is the 6th grade orientation, because I love that we can help the 6th graders and like acclimate them to our culture and make a name and just like hang out with them because they're all funny and they're really nice to hang out with. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Program. These young leaders in front of you give up a week of their summer to come in before school starts to get ready for activities and events for the sixth graders to make for a smooth transition, so it alleviates the fears of the sixth graders and it allows the seventh and eighth graders to demonstrate those leadership capabilities. So excellent program, so thank you all.
I appreciate you all coming tonight too, because that is a lot of work that you all put in. A lot. It's scary when kids are coming to a new school, right? Do you remember that? And so it's nice to have somebody there that understands the way they feel and is there for them right now. And that makes them feel really comfortable, and I think that's a really special thing that you're all doing, so thank you very much. And your teachers, thank you.
Middle school is a time of transition. I really appreciate that you spoke in terms of basic support and golden rule, because you remember of how you felt when you first came into the middle school situation, out of the elementary, very child-centered thing. Now you're expected to be a little more mature in a new environment. That transition is very tough. That's what makes middle school a very special, critical time in a student's life. It's kind of like kindergarten all over again. Home to school, now student-centered, to now you're on your own, working your way to that. So thank you very much.
Thank you, kids. It's really nice to have you guys around. Thank you.
Well, I have a sixth grader named Kenny, so she just went through the web orientation, so I can speak to this. She's definitely been helped by that. It's nice that she knows Paige and knows some of the other kids that kind of help them out. Get comfortable with the middle school experience. She's had a great first entry into middle school, so thank you to you guys as leaders and to the staff at Anthony Elementary.
If I may, I'd like to say something. For the students, thanks for what you guys do. I'll talk as a parent for a minute. My son Ethan started school this week here at Coy Middle School. And it's been very difficult for him going from seventh grade to Fairfield, coming here in the middle of the year as a seventh grader. But he has run into people like you who have reached out to him and talked to him. And that's like the number one question when I walk in the door as a parent: how was your day? And it means something this time, not just how was your day? And because I want to see that progress. So I want to thank you, because you never know where the work that you're doing, how that impacts the kids around you. It does really make a big difference. So I appreciate what you're doing.
I think it makes them feel like part of the family.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming tonight. Okay, you are welcome to stay. We have two more programs, and one of them is going to be a very exciting program. Well, they're both going to be really exciting. One of them will directly impact the middle schools for next year, so you might want to stay for that one if you want. Our next item is program studies, math courses study. That's not the exciting one. But don't tell Mr. Enix that. We'll turn it over to Mr. Enix at this point.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to take just a few minutes today to talk a little bit about our program studies that you have received. I sent a copy of that electronically to the board on, I think that was Tuesday evening. And the program studies is it's an ongoing document that changes every year with some updates and revisions that take place throughout the course of the year. And as we discussed previously at other board meetings, we've really adjusted our master scheduling process for the coming year. It really requires a program of studies to be completed on an earlier timeline than what has been done in the past. So the fact that you are in possession of the drafts of these, and I say drafts because, you know, until they are approved, we still have some adjustments we need to make. But the bottom line is to have them in January for your review and approval. It is earlier than normal, which allows us to stay on task with our master scheduling process that we hope to have a completed master schedule for both our middle schools and high school by the end of the school year. So in order to do that, this document needs to be completed. And when it's completed at this time, what I'd like for at least everyone to understand a little bit about that is it takes an entire effort from all of the buildings and a number of people to make this come together. It really does start as we take a look at a review and revision of the current program to start the school year. We have a course of study process that gets underway, which is math this year. Department chairs facilitate the revision of their courses, the updates or changes to their courses, as well as any of the prescription revisions that happen. As you know, we've been doing some work with our middle schools and restructuring some of the programming offerings that are happening there. So that was a part of this process. And then again, creating and submitting these documents that you now have in front of you, it's a big task. And so it is something that happens over typically a long period of time, but sure, a little bit shorter than normal. So we're excited to be able to present that to you. We really have two very different documents that were shared with you. The first one was from the high school. And this was a much more polished looking document, because the bottom line is there's not a lot of changes to the high school. There are some minor ones. And in this presentation, when I asked Susan Wallace, who's our guidance counselor, one of our guidance counselors and department chairs of the high schools, to submit what those changes were so that you could refer to those in your documents that you have received. But in this presentation, you'll see page numbers and what exactly was what was changed for the high school updates. And so this is a brief review for you. On page 6, there was updated testing information regarding the course exams. We have new College Credit Plus coursework that's being offered, and this time in-house. We have been doing College Credit Plus for the past couple of years to the work of universities and colleges. For the first time next year, we will be offering College Credit Plus courses on campus. We anticipate this really changing the face of College Credit Plus for big high school students, and potentially middle school students as well, but primarily for high school. will open up an entire different opportunity for students that transportation to our local college universities is a struggle. And we have a number of faculty at our high school that have become accredited or credentialed through the universities, through Wright State University, to offer some of their college credit courses. So we're excited about that opportunity and anxious to see what that does for our students in terms of their choice and how that may impact their schedule. So it's a, that's an exciting change for us. There was a printmaking course that was omitted last year. Pages 25 to 33 are the English department courses. There were a few updates to that, just in course names only, to reflect honors and scholarship. And I made a note there that last year, the 9-12 course of study, there was a mid-cycle course of study process that happened at high school last year in 9-12. And there were some revisions and new course offerings that were developed over the course of last year. And that is in its first year of implementation. So, you know, there's we're only right now at the midpoint of the first year of implementation for that. But it's important to note that only that we began the language arts K-12 course of study process for 17-18. We'll be starting this spring. So it'd be a really nice time to be able to look at the first year of the 9-12 adoption and start looking to see what kind of revisions or updates might need to be made when we start that course of study process. So that was the English department. Pages 39 to 43 is the math changes, and we'll talk about that here in just a little bit. Those were fairly significant changes, and we'll discuss those. We have minor course changes in music, as well as PE. PE, what was in there for this year, is that has been removed completely and replaced with a number of different courses entitled Outdoor Education, Team Sports, Lifetime Recreational Activities, Weight Training, and Sports Medicine. So a number of different offerings for our high school students in physical education. We have a few minor changes to some science courses. No description changes, however, these are in course title only. And our social studies department, we added a new course called Law and Society for grades 11 through 12. What we anticipate to happen over the next couple of weeks are just a couple of minor changes to what you would have in your possession right now. These were submitted today by Ms. Laws. We expect a slight change in our government. Not that government is going to change fundamentally, but we'd like to shift that to a junior level course. And the main reason for that is it is part of the required course exam to give our juniors an opportunity to take that as opposed to senior year. When there may not be a second opportunity that the student needs it, is a good thing for our kids. So that is a slight change that we'll be making. One music change from 9-12 to 11-12 only, and then we do have a potential change to our business course description to reflect adding Microsoft 365 and or Google Apps for Education, depending on the direction we decide to go as a district here in the near future. So bottom line is there are going to be a couple of minor changes high school level, but nothing significant to what you have in front of you. So I wanted to share those things with you from the high school. For Ankeny and Coy, it's a little bit of a different process, and your document looks entirely different than what the high school was that was submitted to you. And the reason for that is there are some significant structural changes to the program studies for our middle schools. It is in a strike-through highlight format, which essentially means that what's changed or what's being deleted or changed has a strike-through in it. Anything that you've been given, that, or anything you see as a highlight, is something that is added. So fundamentally, we have some big changes, which means there are entire sections that were deleted and replaced with some new information for you. And what I'd like to do is at least highlight what those things are for you and for our audience tonight. We know that our encore structure has changed dramatically in terms of the semester courses at each grade level. The elective structures, our structure has here semester courses with that as well, and that did require some significant changes to our descriptions of what we anticipate being able to offer in those courses throughout the course of the year. Our career tech offering, we are going to have a presentation after this one from the Green County Career Center, as we've been in partnership with them developing a career tech program that is compliant with our OTE expectations, so we're excited to share that with you. Study hall is now an elective course. Right now it is a required course for all students. Not all students could feel are needing that as We have updated course descriptions per department recommendations, and this was something that was facilitated by our building principals and our department chairs along with our staff. And those were submitted and compiled and put into this document. And of course, we have the math course study for middle school as well. And that is those are some changes we'll talk about in just a few minutes. Just briefly about our course descriptions. Many of the departments did revise those descriptions just to reflect a change in standards or content updates. The encore and elective courses are significantly different in that they're now semesters as opposed to quarter classes. And those quarter classes are not happening every year of the sixth grade. So that is going to be something that has changed and will be a significant course of study change for our encore classes that will be facilitated in the second quarter, second semester, I'm sorry. There's a brief synopsis of the courses offered for students and families to make decisions about what courses they would like to be involved with each year. And something that we are working on, spearheaded by Ryan, is we're working to create 45-second to 1-minute commercials for each of our encore classes. Typically, there's an encore elective fair that happens during parent meetings or possibly during the school day. And rather than do that kind of a model, what we'd like to work on is putting together a presentation to be placed on the web for students and families to go build, take a look at a brief synopsis on video for what these elective courses and encore classes will look like. And that way they can do it at their leisure as opposed to coming to a parent meeting and inundating staff with lots of parents in one place, lots of students in one place. We feel like this might be better for a lot of our students and families to take a look at. So that is something in progress, and with Dale and Sean's cooperation, I think we're going to have a really good opportunity to achieve this for our students and families. As you know, we discussed previously, the required encore courses are a major shift for us in sixth grade health and digital media and tech literacy, seventh grade art and physical education, and eighth grade design thinking and automation and robotics slash life and space course will be in place for the grade and in conjunction with Center. We'll talk about that a little more later. The semester courses do provide a chance for our content areas to be much more in depth than it would have been in a quarter class offering. It does provide more opportunities for students to see a variety of things that happen as opposed to a three-year period. They can see a course from a more in-depth perspective all the time. We feel also that these courses during a sixth through eighth grade program do provide students with a good exploratory experience for all leadership students to have the same experiences to explore the variety of content areas. This is a very exciting change for our students. The elective courses are, again, exactly that. These are options for our students to choose. We have year-long courses. We have semester courses. And there are a number of there that are new to us for this coming year, developed in conjunction with our Women's department chairs in both buildings and their staff. We have a PLA learning lab, we have exploratory, movies and novels, we have reading for enjoyment 1 and 2, school newspaper, literary magazine, public speaking and debates. These are options for our kids that will increase their opportunity to engage with language arts in a different way for those who are interested. And also you'll see there on the second one down, we have an app design and development that is going to be an elective course for our 7th and 8th grade students. That is also a Project Lead the Way course that's in conjunction with Career Center. So I'm very excited about these offerings as electives for our students. And just a reminder that Study Hall is an elective course. They will be able to choose this as either a semester or a full year. Of course, Study Hall is recommended for the student who is motivated and self-disciplined that can complete work on their own. The Study Hall is also a place that provides options for students to get some additional support on homework, study, and anything else that they might need at City Hall for. So it is, again, an option for students to as opposed to a requirement. We have, again, I mentioned the Project Lead the Way courses with the Career Center. Again, we do not currently offer a course at University of State Schools that meets the requirements for career tech. So in that partnership with the Career Center, we decided to offer a course that will be meeting those responsibilities as well as an elective offering for our kids. And you will see a presentation here shortly on those offerings. What I'd like to do now is to transition a little bit away from our her program studies and get into our math course of study for this year. We'd like to take a minute to recognize our two curriculum supervisors that have led the way in our math course of study. Julie Taylor is our lead for this process, as well as Ruth Wiley is the support person collectively. They put in a tremendous amount of work during the first semester to get us to where we are right now. I'll touch on that a little bit more here in just a few minutes to see exactly what changed for this year as opposed to the last several years, and how that impacted how we can get this to you at this time period as opposed to later on. And we had some key focus areas for math course of study. We really wanted a pathway for our kids to reach their graduation requirements by their junior year. And that means reaching Algebra 2. Algebra 2 by the end of junior year is an important one for credit requirements and for those students that need additional time to complete those courses. Not getting Algebra 2 by the time they are a senior gives them an extra opportunity. And that's something that has been happening in high schools all over the area for quite a while. What we've looked at is changing the structure of our courses down to where 8th grade is a high school credit course for all students. Essentially what that is 8th grade content matches up very well with algebra, the first part of algebra content. So that is a high school credit course that we can offer. And many school districts around the area do this already. And again, it just provides an opportunity for students to earn a high school credit earlier than 8th grade and put them on a path to get into their algebra 2 requirement by the time they get their junior. And that's been a key focus for this process. Another key focus is, of course, articulation that reflects the courses needed by grade accelerated students. And we know that we have an increasing number of students that are reaching the point of accelerating the grade level. And that means that we have to adjust what we're doing from that standpoint to accommodate the students. So, again, part of our goal is to in this course of study process, to create an articulation that allows the students that are being grade accelerated to have those courses that they need at the middle school level, even in the fourth and fifth grade level as well. I'd like to switch very quickly to a diagram. And I don't expect you to probably be able to read all of this directly, but what this is the course articulation that you that our students will be able to go on their pathway through, really starting in fourth grade all the way through high school. What you'll see is it starts off in fourth grade with your standard fourth grade content, but for those students that are accelerated, they'll be looking at fourth and fifth grade content in their fourth grade year. And what that does is you'll see that the blocked area underneath there, these are grade accelerated courses, which means that our students will be in fifth grade taking sixth grade content. In sixth grade, they'll be in seventh grade content or pre-algebra. Algebra 1 in seventh grade, sorry. They almost get to geometry as eighth grade. That is a significant number of students that are starting to grow into that in our middle schools and be identified in elementary. So what we need to be able to do is to provide those courses at the middle school level for our students. That's going to change fundamentally the structure of what we're doing with our math program. The rest of this just shows kind of a pathway for students as they are going through their fourth through their 11th grade years. Again, getting algebra 2, you'll see that in the upper right hand side here by the time they're in 11th grade, by the time they're juniors, with a series of different courses, really all the way through, with the students depending on their level of ability, their ability to take on a greater challenge. We have courses that are going to be there ready to be offered. Starting with fourth and fifth grade, yes. We do have electives that are not on there, but you can see the gaps there in 11th and 12th grade where there's not really a defined pathway. That's because once students reach their, once they reach their requirements, then they're open for the electives. Things such as pre-calculus, calculus, statistics, discrete math, AP stats, AP calc, math application, algebra plus courses. So there's a lot of variety for students. And while we don't put that on there directly as a pathway, that's exactly what they have as an opportunity and some choices about the direction we want to go. We've also completed textbook adoptions for the middle school, for middle school and for elementary. In elementary, we are continuing on with math and focus. That is a continuation program, and one of the key components to this is because it's already in place in the district, where our main focus is working on professional development for our staff. We have arranged for 2 full days of training for our staff this school year, preparation for next year. Half of that is our half day, has already happened. also have a full day coming up on February 17th, which is a professional development day, another half day of training on our second professional development day, which is April. So we're utilizing the PD days that we have built into our calendar. That saves us in sub costs, and time out of classroom for staff to train to be successful and not focus. Likewise, for middle school, we have adopted a new program in middle schools called Big Ideas. It is a program that's going to be very well suited to this new course configuration that we have, as their textbooks are really geared towards the multi-year standards that we really need to be able to address for our students. So for those kids that are in a little bit of an accelerated program, like it says 6th and 7th grade content, the books are aligned for that kind of content. So instead of having two books for each two different types of standards, we really have books that are aligned to a combination of standards. That's going to be very big key for our students going forward. Then we've also arranged with that adoption to have 2 days of professional development for middle school staff, and those are aligned on our district professional development days. So we'll be utilizing those days without having time out of classroom and additional sub costs. One of the things that is also in the program studies is just placement revisions. They're condensed. They were previously fairly lengthy. They've been condensed into really different categories to determine how students are placed. Some of that is based on classroom performance, math data with a percentile ranking, above average categories, or above average in all categories for math is used for placement, and the non-measurables of teacher recommendation. It's important to know how students function in the classroom and how well their work ethic goes into their daily efforts. And so it's important to have the teacher recommendation as a part of it. It's really a much more effective process. And our final slide here is just another financial consideration component for our adoption. We've already done the adoption and made the purchases for our math program. We placed the order late December. What this allowed them to do was to give us some significant discounts in those materials. And for elementary, we were able to save $4,907 in shipping costs and textbooks and materials. This is a 6-year adoption that includes all consumable materials for the 6 years. That means we're not having on any dollar figures to really budgets or to our fee schedule for our students. So we're very, very excited about that. And for middle school, by placing the order early December, or late December, I should say, the product and shipping cost saved us $35,590, total of $122,897 just for materials for middle school and elementary. And I also just wanted to point out as well that that's under 50% of the budget for math adoption for this year. So we are very excited to be able to share that information with you. You'll notice there is nothing up there for the high school, as there's not a goal we need to make a major textbook purchase for our high school. There is one set of books that we will need to purchase, that's for statistics, but that's going to be a fairly small number. We still anticipate staying underneath the 50% of our long budget for our course of 79 this year. So, yeah, it's good news to be shared. So, with that, again, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to share this information with you. If you have any questions, try to answer those. If I can't answer it, Julian Ruth, who's been part of the math course of study, might really be able to help me as well, but we're happy to answer questions for you as well.
I do have some questions and comments, but I'm going to defer to Mr. Beskins, because I think they're all in part of it, and I'll all be together. So.
All right.
Okay, thank you, Jason. Okay, our final presentation this evening is from the Greene County Career Center, and that's what we're going to be discussing Project Lead the Way. So I'd like to introduce Mr. Dave Beskins, Superintendent, and Ryan, the Board Supervisor of Satellite Operations.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chapman, this is your demo. Thanks for having us. On behalf of the Greene County Career Center, thanks to each of our board members. Thanks to the staff members who are here tonight, and certainly to Beaver Creek neighbors. I feel really excited to be here. I'm even, believe it or not, more excited. Actually, Mr. Morrison told me that I could have as much time as I needed. So with everyone's permission, we'll just kind of leave one watch here. I thought it would be nice for a little while. Well, he plays with LeBron, who has a long reach and experience with the robotics here. I want to take the opportunity to just talk a little bit about why we're so excited. And Mr. Enos, I know no one's listening to me because they're watching the robot, but I found your delivery to be very exciting. In fact, let me share with you why I found it to be very exciting. Mr. Newport's getting the work out over here. I found this to be very exciting because one of the key components of a Project Lead the Way initiative is enhancing STEM-related skills for kids. And so we know that our math program here at Beaverbury has figured out a pathway that's going to move students through a strong math curriculum that's going to dovetail even nicer to the initiative that we are excited to be partnering with Beaverbury Schools. And the reason that we believe that that's the case is because we are strong believers in the Career Center that together is better. We feel very strongly that when we have the privilege to work with schools in the county, we get to do things collaboratively that enhance and provide different opportunities for kids, and that really excites me. I know you might have found the report on the curriculum a little boring. I was kind of stoked because as a former K-12 superintendent, I spent a lot of time working on that kind of a goal, and I see the benefits of school districts who spend an enormous amount of time planning and building pathways that are rightly designed for kids. And so know that I'm extremely excited by what I saw tonight. Before I begin digging in deeper, I just want to take a moment, and not to steal Mr. Otten's thunder, but to thank all of you as board members. This is, of course, Board Member Appreciation Month in January, and we're just very grateful for your willingness to give time, to leave your families, to come and make decisions for all the kids that you serve in the community. So why are we here? What's this about? So the Green County Career Center is responsible for providing career and technical support for all of the schools in Green County. We are considered what's called the Career Technical Planning District, and by the Ohio Department of Education, what that means is we're responsible for helping all the schools in Green County afford students with learning opportunities around careers and pathways. And that means not only college pathways, but some that will go straight into industry, others that will utilize two-year degree programs, and others that will enter straight into the workforce. And we're responsible for oversight of that, which means we have to make certain that Beaver Creek Schools and Xenia Schools and Fairborn Schools deliver these things in a manner that are appropriate and in compliance with the Ohio Department of Education. So we're considered to be the CTPD, the Career Technical Planning District. And one of the things that makes it really fun for us to be entering a partnership that we're going to share about with you tonight with Beaver Creek Schools is that that's sort of our specialty. So what you heard tonight was the academic focus and the different kinds of course development and the high level achievement on the academic side that's being delivered to students here in our community. I get to say that because I live in Beaver Creek, which you, of course, can look at that as you look for new students. The benefit to us, of course, as a career technical planning district is that we're kind of the experts on providing career exposure and experiences for kids. And so we have constantly been looking for opportunities to get into the member schools more often. I have very much committed a strong desire for us to do a better job as a career center of engaging our communities so that students understand that not all of them have to have an enormous pathway with a gigantic expense for a college degree immediately after completion of school. They can work towards that and find careers and opportunities that make this a really more doable fashion, both for themselves and for their families financially. So why is the timing of this important? Those on the board have heard presentations about the Aerospace Initiative, and so the timing of this couldn't be a better time for us. That initiative continues to move extremely quickly. This morning we were in a phone conversation with our three state representatives and senators here in the area. And we have now had meetings with the Ohio School Facilities Commission, as our legislators have determined and have communicated that it's their intent for an aerospace-related initiative to exist in Green County, and they are directing through legislation. They're making an attempt to direct the School Facilities Commission to support an aerospace-driven career center in Green County. that will support all of the schools here in the county. This is pretty big news. We've been working diligently on this for some time. It's taken an enormous amount of time and planning. We're not there yet, but we have a lot of momentum. And this Project Lead the Way initiative that's going to open next year in Beaver Creek is an exciting opportunity that's going to blow the doors open on that. Project Lead the Way is a national curriculum. Mr. McCourt will share a little bit more with you about that in a moment. But Project Lead the Way is a national developed curriculum that was developed by a nonprofit company to just solely enhance and increase students' intellects and abilities in the areas of engineering and engineering technologies. And so they have a number of different pathways that they offer. We have, of course, because of the aerospace initiative here in the county, we have focused just extensively on the aerospace side of that. And so we're going to be talking a little bit about that with you. Here's why I'm thrilled about it. Beaver Creek Superintendent and Mr. Otten and Mr. Enix approached us several months ago, and they said, you know, we have not been in compliance with our career tech middle school programming, and we've had to ask for a waiver from the state because that's not something that our kids have had exposure to, and we want that to change. That led to some really extensive discussion that we believe has now led to one of the most exciting things happening in Greene County, because we are planning next year through the Career Center here at Beaver Creek Schools to begin delivering flight and space and other types of Project Lead the Way programming to students in your community starting in the middle grades. That's immensely exciting. There are not a lot of schools in the state providing that level of educational opportunity to their kids in middle school. And so you're going to be leading the way with many of them by what it is that you're doing. So you also will get to have some playtime tonight. You know, I know LeBron was carrying my watch around here as Mr. McCourt traveled and played a little bit. This is actually a robot in one of our high school Project Lead the Way programs in Xenia. This robot actually was devised to pick up, go retrieve, pick up, and deliver back. So our students built it. Our students programmed it. Our students figure out all the software configurations to make it do what it's told from a simple game remote. And those are the kinds of things your students are going to be learning, and they're going to be learning that in your middle grades to begin with. So that should be very exciting to all of you. It's certainly very, very exciting to us. These giveaways that we give you, they're going to be really small examples of what we think are going to be some of the most creative, insightful, engineered style thinking for our kids. And we are confident that you're going to be very excited by what your kids and students are talking about and what you see young people coming up with, developing, creating, and then producing. And so as I turn the table over here to Mr. McCourt, I just want to let you know that he has had a really huge responsibility on behalf of the Career Center. Last year in December, I pulled him off of his regularly assigned duty, and I assured him that we were going to have things be different in the homeschools in Greene County, and we were going to begin to provide opportunities for kids like they had never seen. And so he was pulled from his responsibilities on campus, and his job is to be in the buildings of all 7 school districts in this county every day of the week if possible, but at minimum on a weekly basis, so that you can understand differently what career and technical education means for students, and so that they can get the exposures that help them make right choices. Again, developing a right pathway for a future. So with that having been said, I turn it over to Ryan.
Thank you, I appreciate it, Mr. Haskins. Just thanks to the board and Beaver Creek for having us this evening. It's always an exciting time for freshmen and sophomores, and if they truly love it, then that's a pathway that they can continue on into the Career Center. And part of that is because the cost that's associated with some of these labs is truly pretty large. And so we can't duplicate that in all 7 school districts. So the thought is to put that at a career center, and then the students would travel to the career center to gain that experience. So that's what where it brings in the feeder programs that would feed into those types of things. Because it's important to remember, you know, when we talk about woodshop, and we talk about some of these things that have gone away and come back, so it's important for these students to learn life skills, how to build a birdhouse, maybe how to use a small welder, how to wire up a light switch. Do some of those things as homeowners we all would like to be able to do, so we wouldn't have to pay somebody else to do it. So some of the skill sets are important to learn, no matter what you do as a career in the future. But for those kids that really learn it and love it, then they can go on to the Career Center and kind of dive into some of those electrical wiring, welding, those types of labs. So just a little did you know about the Career Center satellites. First of all, we have over 1,800 students in all seven schools in Gray County. So we supervise all those 1,800 students. We have 19 instructors at different levels. The reason I put the middle school piece on there is because that's something new to Career Tech that started about 3 years ago. It used to only be 9 through 12 that you could offer Career Tech in and receive funding from the state for, and that has changed now to offer it to the 7th and 8th grade level. So that's why if you're hearing or seeing a little more about Career Tech in the middle school levels, more so than you ever have in the past, that's why. So we're in 11 different facilities, and that includes Soy Medical Center, in a program we have called Project Search, and then we'll be expanding out to Green Memorial Hospital in Xenia next year. So more, even more than just in school facilities is their programming. So this graph just gives you a little quick picture of where we're at. So in all the schools, you can see the school listed there and then the programs listed underneath of it. Beaver Creek is right there. When we talk about the number of students that we have in satellites, I told you we have a little over 1,800 students. I will tell you that when this pathway to Beaver Creek gets fully implemented, that will double, literally, the amount of students that we have in the satellite program. So that's pretty incredible that we're able to bring Career Tech and have access for that number of kids in Grant County. So that will certainly double it as we go across the board, and Beaver Creek is going to be leading that way and leading the charge in our satellites, I think, in the future with programming as we move down the road. So Mr. Deskins kind of alluded to some of the goals that we have. I've been a satellite teacher, and when I say that, I was an ag teacher and an FFA advisor at a school where I wasn't associated with the Career Center, and it can be kind of feels like you're on an island a little bit because you're not an academic teacher and you're not necessarily working for the homeschool, and you feel kind of like there's not a lot of support there. That's where I come into play. So one of the big goals that we have in my role is to improve that level of customer service to our teachers, to our students, but even more so to the homeschools to kind of discuss Career Tech education. You can ask every one of your administrators that you have at Beaver Creek, but we all met this summer. It's all about educating the principals to kind of let them know where their options are and where it lies with Career Tech, and that's really how this whole thing got started. Was we started to have those meetings and discussion about the options with Career Tech, and it really started to make some change for us. One of the other goals is that we better align our current programming to offer pathways, opportunities for students. So just to quickly define what a pathway is, we've been used to in the past just kind of having sprinkled in electives. That a kid could just, I feel like doing underwater basket weaving today, so I'm gonna go take underwater basket weaving. But that doesn't really have any real connection to industry, and there's no real ability for that student to garner some type of industry credential or some type of college credit. With pathways, we align students' course offerings so that when they get into a pathway and they want to continue that pathway, they have opportunities to earn college credit. They have opportunity to get some type of industry credential that they can take with them when they go beyond high school. And one of the things that comes up a lot, we get asked about when we talk about these pathways, is you expect kids to make these decisions when they're this young about what they want to do as a career. And I always go back to some of the ladies that we have in cosmetology at the Career Center, and they'll say, I don't know that I want to cut hair the rest of my life, but I know that when I earn my licensure to be a licensed cosmetologist, that they can't take that from me. And that I will always have that. And when I get to college, I'll be able to get a job that pays a lot more than just being a server at Texas Roadhouse, and I can help offset some of the costs that I'll have in college. So that's pretty forward thinking for a student at that age. But those are the types of things that we want to get to parents and to students to start thinking about those thought processes as they go. So we want to make sure that we increase the opportunities for students across Green County to have these opportunities in both the middle school and the high school. So what's that going to look like for you in this engineering program that we're going to be offering next year at Ankeny and Coy Middle School? Just real quickly, we're going to be hiring 4 instructors, so there'll be 2 instructors at each building. The 7th grade will be able to take 2 different courses that will run right up against each other. One's called Computer Science for Innovators and Makers, and the other one's called App Creators. Now, we decided to put those together and call it App Design and Development for the course guidebook. The names that you see up here are what Project Leadway actually calls them. And it's interesting because we talk about how fast technology changes. Just in the amount of time that we've been doing planning, When we first started planning, these two courses were just simply called Intro to Computer Sciences 1 and 2. And in the time that we've been talking and through this process, it's now changed, and Project Leadway has updated the curriculum because, especially in computers, it changes so fast that Project Leadway is constantly sending out updates to ensure that the curriculum that's being delivered is up to date and not antiquated. So just in the time that's changed. In the eighth grade, that will be your required course. The students will be able to take flight, space, and automation and robotics. And again, that just mirrors at both schools. So what are you going to see? So if Mr. Deskins, you could help me pass out some of the fun stuff.
Some toys. So I believe our 3D printers were utilized this week at one of our school districts to create some beavers sitting on a stump with engravement for Project Lead the Way, Beaver Creek City Schools, and the Green County Career Center. One of the nice things about the Project Lead the Way curriculum is that it's a prescribed curriculum, but immensely quickly updated. And so by prescribed curriculum, I mean this. Every instructor who's teaching a Project Lead the Way engineering program is required to participate in a summer learning session before they're eligible to deliver the curriculum within that program. So it's very focused, it's very up to date. There are certain delivery models that they've researched for many, many years and have figured out are proven practices and best practices and strategies. So for us, again, that's a pretty nifty thing. The second item that you're looking at, this is just a little coaster. The little coaster was made, I believe, with our laser engraver at Yellow Springs Schools?
Yep.
Okay. And this has a little carved out face of a beaver, and it has the beaver's logo on the front of it. It also has a Project Lead the Way and Green County Career Center logo. Again, all of this was computer programmed and printed out on a laser printer from one of our school districts. By the way, these are the projects that are done by kids. These are the things they figure out. They figure out how to program it to place the beaver in the center, on the side, upside down, to do whatever it is they wish to do with it. They learn those application skills. So for us, that's pretty critical.
It was the process for how this happened was when we knew we were going to be coming to present, I called my instructor, the 3D printer. We were at Fairholme with that. I said, listen, I don't know what I want it to look like, but that's what you're for. You're the engineer design. Give it to the kid. I said, we just have a partnership with Beaver Creek City Schools, Project Lead the Way Engineering, and the Green County Career Center. Go. That's how it works in the classroom for these instructors. This time it was coming from the supervisor. And so he came back to me literally within like 30 minutes and said, the kids have, here's what we got. What do you think? And he shoot me pictures on my cell phone. And ultimately, this is what we landed on. It took 24 hours to print all these items. And the kids got it all set up, made sure it was all good to go, let it print overnight, came back to school the next thing, first thing in the morning, check on it, all that kind of stuff. So they kind of designed the 3D model. Now, the idea around giving the 2D also is that when you have these Project Lead the Way programs and you go through what's called the engineering design process, is the students will be thinking outside the box, how are we going to do this, or what it's going to look like? And we have to make sure that they are surrounded by the equipment that they need to support that creativity. And I'm telling you, I've been now to 12 different middle school Project Lead the Way programs over the last few months, from Indiana all the way down to the river. And putting these kids in environments where they can apply the things that they're learning, and then putting equipment around them to where they're not just thinking it and drawing it on paper and then that's when it stops, but where they can actually put it into a piece of equipment and have things like this come out, I mean, the kids just take off. I mean, it's a different learning environment when you walk into these rooms. So most of the time you're used to a classroom where you walk in, the kids are kind of funneling in and they're messing around talking about stories about what happened over the weekend, and the teacher's got to get them going. Come on, let's get focused, got to get started. In a Project Lead the Way engineering classroom, you don't see that. They come in, they get started, they're excited.
So as LeBron brings my watch back, Mr. McCord, we want to stop because we've taken plenty of your time to answer any questions that you may have and allow you to get on with the continuing business. I just want to say thank you again, Mr. Otten, for engaging in the conversation, future needs for your work. I know a lot of your team have done that. Mr. Nellis, our board representative, thank you very much for continuing to support us here. Thank you, LeBron, and giving us the opportunities that we have. At this time, are there any questions that we can answer for you?
Sure.
Mr. Morrison, I now have my watch back down on my regular time.
Questions and comments? Okay. I want to thank Mr. Hicks, Mr. Deskins, and Mr. McCourt for their presentations. Obviously, they were excellent, so thank you very much. I also want to thank Mr. Hicks in particular for working with the middle school principals, Mr. Ren, Mr. Kelly, department chairs, the staff, bringing together the course description booklet, because that was something that we heard was important, and you've done just that. So thank you very much. This is exciting, and it's extremely ambitious. The opportunities that we're going to be giving our young people, I think, are awesome. Almost makes me wish I could go back to middle school again. But I guess what I'm waiting to see how it's all going to work out is that if I'm going to be in eighth grade next year in Ankeny or in McCoy, what I'm waiting to see is, again, well, let me, before I say that, first of all, I want to congratulate, make sure everybody knows that every child in middle school can take an exploratory foreign language class. I think that is so important that we do that. So sixth, seventh, and eighth graders can take exploratory foreign language. Eighth graders can take a full year high school credit in either German or French or Spanish. And I think that is awesome that the Beaver Creek Schools gets to offer that. Which leads me to what the opportunities are for our kids and the difficult choices that they're going to have to make next year. Because if I'm understanding correctly, looking through the course syllabus, every eighth grader must take English language arts, they must take math, they must take science, they must take social studies, they must take strategies for success. Then they can take a year of foreign language or exploratory foreign language. We have a music department here in Beaver Creek that is second to none. We have 300 students in our marching band, so we're going to have a large number of students wanting to take band. We have a choir and a show choir that put on phenomenal performances. They're champions everywhere they go. So we're going to have kids saying, we have to choose between band and choir, right? And now we have required automation, robotics, and flight in space. Right? So I mean, what opportunities, all right, for our young people? It is so exciting that I think the problems you're going to hear are, how can we do all this in one day? So I guess that's a nice problem to have, but I still see it's going to be difficult. But I think it's just so exciting and so ambitious. So I applaud you. Thank you.
I think the great part about all this is the hands-on learning. That's what I'm excited about. You know, when kids have actively involved in learning classes, they don't only learn, they retain what they learn. And what I like about this is look at the workforce ready. And that's the issue around here. You know, I mean, that's what everybody's workforce development, that's what everybody's looking for. So I mean, this is just, go Beaver Creek, I mean, thank you for your service. This, I just can't even imagine.
You know, along the lines of the workforce development that Mr. Gano, the whole focus for the aerospace initiative was based on a data collection that the Career Center went through now almost a year and a half ago. That data collection identified three predominant job market needs in our region where thousands of jobs are going to become available in the next few years. Those three major areas are in the areas of aerospace related to engineering, because Wright-Patt Air Force Base is the largest single-site employer in Ohio. They receive the largest amount of federal funding for research and development, utilizing a large number of engineering kinds of research backgrounds. The second area of identified job need in the region is around the area of manufacturing, which includes aerospace manufacturing. Well, guess what robotics is? It's manufacturing. So we're preparing, and then of course the third area is information technologies. And we're seeing even more of that in our region around aerospace. When you look at Sinclair Community College and their UAV program, when you look at Springfield, who has become a unique sited location for UAVs, this region of the state has some pretty powerful reasons for Project Leeway Engineering that focuses around aerospace. Mr. Morrison, you're exactly right. A, I wish I were a kid again. Some days I am. And secondly, I very much think it's a great chance for kids to have to fight the hard fight of deciding what's the most fun. So
I've got a question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Could I audit that with all of you points?
Do you audit it?
Sit the half like.
Yeah, one of the things, that's a great question though, because you've raised a really interesting point. One of the things that our data collection told us about the app design piece is that our kids like the game. They like to play, right? If you all have children or teach children, they're constantly on something on their phone. So one of the things that they're learning is how to do the playing of that, but they're not learning how to develop that software and redesign that software so that when it comes time for Mario to jump forward, he doesn't jump backwards. And so this app design class at a young age starts getting those kids interested in playing very differently inside of the mind of a computer. So yeah, you are more than welcome to come out and argue with everyone. Thank you again very much. Really appreciate your time.
I would just like to thank Dave and Ryan. We kind of jumped into this exploring these opportunities, and Dave never backed down. So I just want to thank both of them for what you're going to be able to provide our students.
Thank you. And your team also. It's been a good process, and it's been nice to have the late full dance.
I think we're very fortunate to have the team that we have here with the leadership in the cabinet. I mean, truly, our school district is very fortunate. These kids are extremely fortunate. I mean, they are going to be even more, all of you looking out for them the way you are, the opportunities here are ahead for them. So thank you so much, really. This is exciting.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for these great presentations. This was really interesting. We are now on to approval. I think that's the motion to say. For approval of the chair to present. Any discussion?
Ms. Hunt?
Yes.
Ms. Sarno?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Regano?
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Okay, we have no questions or comments from the public, so we're moving on to the approval of the meeting held. We're going to take a motion to second the minutes from December 2016 for the education meeting, December 13th, 2016, regular meetings.
No move.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Hunt?
Yes.
Ms. Arnold?
Yes.
Ms. Regano?
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
A financial report request. I'm making a motion is second to approve. Okay, resolution to accept the amount of tax rate for tax year 2016 collection year and 2017 determined by the Green County, Montgomery County Budget Commission, bond levy and emergency levy rates, and December 2016 financial reports, amended certificate of fiscal year 17, estimated resources and appropriations, donated items, and also the resolution declaring the intent to proceed with election of the question of substitution of emergency tax levy.
Item A, the resolution to accept the amounts of the tax rate to be year 2016 and 17 collection year. Again, we'll strike, and I will fix it in the minutes for us. We won't include Green County in there, only Montgomery County, because that's all that it was available, as we talked at the last meeting, the tax rate meeting. But on page 66 is where your Montgomery County tax rates are. Our center. December fiscal financial report is on page 67, and again, we're very close to being in alignment with our projections just for the month and to date. Again, you know, we are continuously monitoring, but we're within 0.13%. So I think we're right in alignment with our 5-year forecast with it predicted. So like I said, always say we're always monitoring that. types of funds that we can invest in. You will see down at the bottom of the little piece signs, the graphs are, and it says agency funds or FDIC insured or other funds. All of our funds are within the 5 years, and our weighted average maturity is 1.42 and 1.43%, which is pretty good given the rates that you get today. The maturity is almost 2 years. So the one thing that you'll see as we keep going, as our bottom line or as our available funds for investing start to diminish, because like we looked at the five-year forecast and we talk about when we're going to need new money or when we start running out of money, as that starts diminishing, you will see these numbers and these meter reports, these investments will again, you know, diminish as well. So the one thing I always say to people is that, you know, the reason we have to stay within budgets and we have to have a plan on cash flow and things is because our monies, we've had some discussions at the higher level, but it's because our monies are not just sitting in a bank account for you guys to spend. I don't just have that authority. I mean, we come up with our five-year forecast, we come up with an appropriation resolution that turns into budgets. Those are our limits for the year, and everything else gets invested. We invest that money so that we can at least make some type of a return and be good stewards with the taxpayer dollars. I don't spend a lot of time on that because it becomes, you guys were good last year, I think you're bored. Page 85 is the donations that we typically talk about, and then on page 86 is the resolution that follows up with putting the substitute emergency levy, which is a renewal, on the ballot in May. And we already done the levy of necessity last month, and then we had the county auditor certify, and now we're on page 86 is the last resolution that you will need so that we can put that levy on the ballot in May.
But I'll tell you, halfway through the fiscal year, which we are in December, and if we looking at revenues, anticipated revenues, and anticipated expenditures, and we 99.87% correct, that is, it is amazing. So, kudos. Yes.
Mr. Dunlap?
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Okay, on to new business. And the motion is second to approve the joint salary changes, leaves, absence, and terminations, and employee code conduct.
But yes. Joanne, I appreciate
the meeting. I appreciate right on another job, so I appreciate you being here.
I think we probably have about 25 staff members who are in this room. So, I think it was good work. That concludes what I have to do with this.
Okay.
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Ms. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Motion carries.
So, we have superintendent's report.
Yeah, I'm going to go to the voting. They provide to our children and families of Beaver Creek City School District. These five individuals have made many important decisions that have impacted Beaver Creek students, families, teachers, and administrators throughout their tenure. Many of these decisions were not easily or hastily made.
Some may have drew criticism and discomfort from the community, while others were applauded. I'm so thankful to have been given a front row seat to watch these men and women put emotion and personal interest aside to deliver a decision that is always in the best interest. That's always in the best interest of our students and this community. I can assure you that there were many opportunities that an easier decision could have been made. This board never wavered from their objective to do the right thing for students and to make Weaver Creek City Schools the very best they can be. Serving as a school board member is not an easy job. You stand on an island in your community, you become an easy target for criticism, and everyone believes that they could do a better job. One day you win the popular vote of the community, and the next day you're ridiculed for a decision that you have made. So you may ask yourself, why would anyone do this job? I am certain that each of our school board members would state that the positive moments with our students that each have experienced over the years overwhelmingly outweighs the difficult or stressful moments of this position. Their work is changing lives and shaping this community. Personally, I've enjoyed getting to know our board over the past 9 months, and I am thankful to be able to have the opportunity to work beside them as they continue to do great things for our students in this wonderful community. Please join me in expressing our deepest gratitude and sincere appreciation for all the work that they do every day. Because what I'd like to do first, just like we have our students come up, we're going to have you come up. So our first one is Mrs. Arnold. Mrs. Arnold,
come up. Hey,
you get to and then we're going to have you stand in front here, Mrs. Arnold. So this is actually from the Ohio School Board Association, and says, in sincere appreciation for exemplary leadership and service to public schools, presented to Peg Arnold, Beaver Creek City Schools, School Board Recognition Month, January 2017. Congratulations. Okay, Mrs. Hunt. And yours says the same thing, except for Mrs. Hunt. Hey, Mr. Morrison. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
degrees, got over 10. It's great, they have 20, altogether they only 24 show choirs coming from out of state, in state. It's a fabulous 2 days. I mean, it starts at 6 o'clock tomorrow night, you purchase the tickets at the door. And it's Saturday morning, it starts 8 o'clock in the morning, goes until like 12 o'clock at night. So it's all day. It's middle school tomorrow night, high school will be Saturday. So do yourselves a favor and attend. You'll just, you'll love it. They're just amazing, let's just put it that way. Our show choirs are top notch. So that's tomorrow and Saturday. January 16th, there's no school, Martin Luther King Day. January 27th, Chamber of Commerce Celebration of Excellence Gala. January 30th, Board of Education Work Session, Board Retreat at 6:30, right here in the Board Administration Building. And the next Board of Education meeting is February 16th, 2017 at 6:30, right here where you're all sitting. And we're at board comments, Mr. Scott.
Thank you to the Captain, Mr. Rockman, for the nice gift and the certificate. I'm honored to serve on the school board.
Yes, thank you. I did appreciate that. Appreciate the gift very, very much. I'd like to congratulate all of our winter athletic teams, boys and girls basketball team, both having very successful seasons. Wrestling team doing well. They just won the Beaver Creek Invitational wrestling tournament last weekend. Our swim team is doing exceptional, both boys and girls. They compete in 2-day tournament just Friday and eventually Saturday and Sunday. And also congratulations to our bowling team.
Great presentation. I think it just speaks to a culture that we have in Beaver Creek that makes Beaver Creek such a great place to live in, to raise children in, to have attended schools. And so it just is an amazing reflection on that. As far as the Web Kids presentation from Ankeny, again, that's a real cultural issue and very sensitive to middle school students' needs through that transition process. It's really important to have kids like Webb to help who have been through the path, to help lay the path for the other one. And as well, it's quite an honor to serve with the board members that we have. It's been one of the best years that I've had. It's a pleasure to serve the community and the students in Beaver Creek Schools. So thank you, guys.
I really like what's going on right now in the district. There's a synergy that I think we need for quite a while. And just seeing the new ideas starting to come in and work their way into the curriculum. And I personally think that it would be good if we had been planning our schedules out a lot earlier than we were in the past. I mean, that's always been a last minute for holy cow, you know. How can the kids register? They don't have the schedules ready, but I'm just happy about where things are going and the people that we have here. Thank you for coming. Those of you that are new and those of you that have been here for a while. Good group.
And I'd like to thank all the board members. This is amazing. I want to thank our administrators for being so forward thinking. We're going out there and fighting for our kids. I know it's a lot of hard work. And I know, you know, get hit with, I'm happy with this, I'm not happy with this, but you know what? But your hearts are there for our kids. You know what? At the end of the day, that's why we're all here. At the end of the day, we can't say this decision was made for the good of our kids. And why are we doing it all? And that's what this board and this community is all about. That's what I love about these groups. People are so into these schools and so into the kids, and they want what's best for them. And this is truly an amazing school system. I know I could actually, I know it is because I've taught in it for 24 years, so I can say this really is a fabulous school district because I know what it's all about from the bottom up to your level. And I really want to thank you for all you do for us, for your leadership, the team you have assembled, for all you out there. Thank you so much, because I know the work that goes into what you do above and beyond what people could ever even imagine. I want to thank the principals out there for all you do. That's tough running these schools. I mean, I, you know, you're running little baby corporations, really. That's what you are. You're running. When I walk into those middle schools and the high school, it's like, it's a corporation coming from the elementary school, where it's, you know, the nurturing thing, and it's our little babies. I love them. And then they move on to the middle school and then to the high school. The first time I ever took my fifth graders to the high school, we went into one of them, the science labs. I went to spend the morning there. And we get there, and all of a sudden, they're changing classes. I said to them, freeze, just get up against the wall, because people are coming from there. And you know, these little third graders are like, what just happened? And you just don't realize what goes on in the other buildings. It is amazing. So thank all of you for what you do. You truly are appreciated more